And welcome to the second meeting of the 2015 of the Pentland Hills Regional Park Boundary Bill Committee. Everyone present is asked to switch off their mobile phones and other electronic equipment as they affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members may consult tablets during the meeting. This is because we provide meeting papers in digital format. I'd like to welcome Christine Graham to today's meeting as a member in charge of the bill, and also Colin Keir, MSP, is in attendance. Both will be allowed to question the witnesses after the committee have asked their questions. Our only item of business today is the evidence in the Pentland Hills Regional Park Boundary Bill. Our first panel represents local authorities affected by the bill, and I welcome Alan McGregor, Regional Park Manager, City of Edinburgh Council, Chris Alcorn, Principal Planner, Planning and Economic Development, West Lothian Council, James Kinch, Land Resources Agent, Midlothian Council, Ian Aikman, Chief Planning Officer, Scottish Borders Council, Malcolm Muir, Countryside and Greenspace Manager, South Lanarkshire Council. Good morning. Under the Parliament's Standing Orders, committees cannot meet at the same time as the Chamber, therefore the meeting must come to a close at 11.35 at the latest. It would be helpful then if members could keep their questions brief and if responses could be concise. Due to time constraints, we will move straight to questioning without opening remarks. This will allow everybody an opportunity to contribute. And as I said, it's my intention to allow Christine Graham and Colin Keir to question witnesses after members have concluded their questioning. I'd like to start off by asking the witnesses if any of them are aware of any demand for an extension to the Pentland Hills Regional Park. Would anybody like to kick off? Mr. Kinch?
We've not received any particular demand as council officers for an extended regional park, but then we might not be the natural people to be spoken to.
Yeah. And is there any other councils that have received such a demand?
No, we haven't. I think obviously as a planner, we normally go through the planning process, and these matters are identified through main issues reports and such like, either through CESS plan or through local development plan, and that has not been an issue which has been of particular relevance to the Borders community.
Okay.
But as far as South Lanarkshire goes, we've had no indication of demand.
Thank you very much. Mr. McGregor?
Yep, from City of Edinburgh Council's perspective, no direct demand. However, in its capacity as managing the existing regional park, there's a recognition that the recreational usage of the Pentland Hills extends beyond the existing boundary. However, that's not been expressed directly in terms of a demand to extend the boundary at this stage.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Alcorn?
From West Lothian side, similar to Scottish Borders, recently just conducted our main issues report, and the Pentland Hills was in there, and there was no substantial response other than, I think, perhaps Kirk Newton Community Council were split, whether they thought it was a good thing to extend it or a bad thing, but they're split on a number of issues.
They have been a member of community councils, I know how that works. So that's the only organisation that mentioned the extension of the park then?
Yeah.
Right, okay, thanks very much. Mike, would you like to?
Yes, thank you, convener. And good morning. I'm interested in exploring, in the first instance, how effective the current park is in meeting its various objectives to retain the character of the area, protect and enhance it, and to encourage responsible access and so on and so forth. So how effective is the current park in meeting its objectives?
Park, it's approximately 27 years now since it's been designated, so there's a fair track record of providing visitor management services within the northern area of the Pentland Hills. I guess to an extent that's for others to judge in terms of how effective it is. I'm speaking in my capacity as working for City of Edinburgh Council, that's the current lead authority for the existing park. We've certainly endeavoured over the period to provide effective visitor management services, and the core of that is around catering for the visiting public around access points, footpaths, rights of way, signage and waymarking, visitor centres, providing information and advice for visitors about where to go, how to enjoy the Pentland Hills in a responsible fashion. So there's about 27 years of incremental work in that regard, and I think if you visit the existing regional park, I'd like to think that's fairly evident, that it's a kind of managed landscape in terms of the facilities that are there for visitors so they can enjoy the countryside responsibly, on top of the existing land uses such as farming and military training and water supply. And that's been the idea really all along, is to provide a level of service to assist visitors to enjoy the hills responsibly while managing the landscape and also the impact on existing land uses.
Any other witnesses care to comment? Okay. I'll move on, convener, I think, to my next question, which is really to see, to ask to what extent, if, you know, I'm interpreting what you've said as largely positive. So the next question I have really is to explore whether or not the area currently out with the park, but within the scope of this bill, to what extent these objectives may or may not already be being met in that area. So, perhaps, all or any of the witnesses might care to comment on that.
Pick up from Scottish Borders side, obviously, in that the area which where the proposed extension is in the borders, we have a series of core paths, promoted paths, and obviously there are a series of environmental designations within that area. So in terms of the environmental quality of that area and in terms of people's access to that area, that is already available at that moment in time. And obviously we're balancing that provision within the balance of the rest of the borders in terms of the large area that we deal with. So there is access there already. So would the designation of the park actually change that or assist or aid meeting these objectives? I think in many cases they are being, a lot of it are being met already.
From the South Lanark perspective, we don't concur with that exactly. We have core paths in the area and we actually can't see what real advantages there would be to public access or to natural heritage protection under the regional park designation that can't be delivered under existing legislation. Of course, there is a matter of resources. It depends on the scale of facilities you would want to put into an area such as that, but that has to be dictated by the presence of, you know, significant populations. We understand for the regional park designation at the Edinburgh end, our main populations where there are health challenges, etc., tend to be up on the fringes of Glasgow and around there, and this is a very peripheral area for them.
Very small extension proposed. It's only around about 22 square kilometres, 6 or 7 properties, a couple of farms, one business. Scottish Water have the reservoir that they're looking to sell. Forestry Commission Scotland have a number of woods that they're looking to sell. No core paths, one right of way. Probably the key thing from our side is there's a area of special conservation, Craigengar Moss, quite a large moss right down in the corner of West Lothian as it butts onto Scottish Borders and South Lanarkshire. So it was really a very, you could say, the remotest part of West Lothian. And we've had a number of wind farm proposals, particularly in that area. Scottish ministers refused Fock Hill last year. That farm is now up for sale. So in terms of recreational impact, if the wind farm had been there, there would have been a significant change. But now that has... has receded. There's very little pressure we see on that area, and there's no plans. We have no budget to spend anything in that area.
Okay, thank you. If I could just have a brief follow-up here, because, and to my shame, I suppose, I've never been to this park. I represent the Highlands and Islands, and I normally stravague about the Highlands and Islands, but as I do so, I try and sometimes put myself in the mindset of a visitor, a tourist to that area, to try and gain some kind of understanding from that perspective. So if I were to, and now as a result of this bill and sitting in this committee, I'm going to make a particular point of visiting the park. But when I visit the park and when I then go and visit this other area, is there anything as a visitor, any difference that I would notice in terms of my experience? I mean, I appreciate this is difficult territory. It's maybe a bit subjective. It might be more fitting to ask, I don't know, a poet to write about this, but I'm sure Wordsworth would have covered it adequately. But you understand what I'm getting at. If, how would, what difference would I notice as a visitor?
we just address that briefly. There's a phrase in one of the existing aims of the current regional park which refers to the essential character. And I think as a starting point, that essential character is an important thing. The current aims of the existing park is not to turn the upland landscape and the Pentland Hills into anything other than it is, which is a working landscape, largely farmed. People have been walking there for many years, and there's an essential character to a visit to that area that is of import itself, and that's the value of the recreational experience. So I would imagine that should a boundary extend further into the southern hill range, that essential character would be the essence of what the park would be attempting to try and conserve and look after for current and future generations. So in a sense, it would be subtle. And I would suspect that the facilities and the level of visitor management that would be provided in an extended area would be sensitive to that essential character. So it's subtle.
Thank you. Yeah. Great, thank you. Alec, you'd like to come in?
Just if I could have a brief supplementary, convener. Yes, I find... good morning, gentlemen, by the way. I find this quite interesting, because I think what we've determined... I think it was Mr. McGregor who described the current park as providing a slightly more managed recreational environment, if I can put it that way. I don't want to put words in your mouth, but an increased level of management, I think, was the phrase you used. And I can absolutely understand the need for that, where there is the pressure that would come to being in very close proximity to a city, where the current park is, but pressure being the operative word that I'm looking at here. Now, everybody else has mentioned the current legislation on access, on core paths, that provides a level of management, but sort of unmanaged rather than managed, in a way that something in the regional park would be. And the question I'm really going to ask is, in the area that is being proposed, is the pressure of recreational use such that an increased level of management is required, in your view?
Short answer from me, though.
And from South Lanarkshire, no.
Well, then can't see any pressure there at all.
I think that answers my question, convener. Thank you.
Couple of questions.
Thank you much, convener. Could I ask a general question to all the witnesses about finance, which is obviously one of the key aspects, and obviously the committee have read all your evidence with lots of interest. Can I start with the existing situation that we have? I mean, across the board in local authorities and beyond, obviously finance is a big constraining factor, and we all appreciate that. Perhaps the witnesses could tell me a little bit more then about the problems, constraints and opportunities of financing under the existing regime. Could I perhaps start with Mr. Alcorn on my right, on my left?
Obviously, we have only 10% of the existing park area, and as part of the memo of understanding that was drawn up in 1986, the proportion of the budget is related to that. So I think 15,000-16,000 is what we spend at the moment, so maybe half a ranger's post. In the context of, you know, our access budget for the whole of West Lothian is 60,000 capital budget. We used to have a revenue budget of 32,000. That's recently been halved to 16,000, again, for the whole of West Lothian. In this particular area, again, no core paths, so the pressure, the priority has not been in this area at all. And currently, we actually don't have an access officer in post, hoping to recruit one, but that's been 3 years now. So the existing settlement, which the council's just agreed for 3 years, doesn't make any provision for any expansion or additional staff or additional resources for access or environmental works in this area at all, let alone the existing park.
So, would you say then that you're not meeting some of the current objectives that you've set yourselves, or are you just, is your head just above ball water in terms of how the finance operates for your particular authority?
Just in relation to this area. We also have, I'm chair of Harperig Reservoir Local Nature Reserve Management Committee that involves residents, landowners, land managers, and their view is they have quite a few issues there, and supported by City of Edinburgh Council and the Ranger, we're able to work through the management plan for that area. But again, because of the visitor pressure being light in that area, it's mainly farm-specific environmental issues rather than you know, a large number of visitors. So if without the council contributing to the park and the staff resource from Edinburgh Natural Heritage Service working in this part of the park. Our own existing countryside services couldn't provide that ranger cover in that area.
Thank you. Mr. McGregor.
Yeah. From Edinburgh's perspective, and I would imagine this is similar for the majority or all of the existing partners, is no surprise that local authority budgets are under very strong pressures at the moment. And the current funding arrangement depends on the three local authorities providing revenue funding to provide an integrated service in the existing park. No surprise that that is under pressure. And I would say you asked the question about are we keeping our head above water? I would say yes. However, historically, there has been a decline in the overall budget for the park in terms of staff numbers, staff input, and funding that's available for projects and doing things on the ground. So it's been a challenge. However, I think there is still a credible service provided thanks to the continued partnership from the three local authorities. But it is the case that that is a challenge to maintain. And as we look ahead to the years to come, I think that will continue. But at the moment, we have a credible and viable service for the existing park. But it's a challenge to maintain.
You're the lead authority, aren't you?
Yeah, do
you find there's any creative tension with your other colleagues in terms of, well, we've spent that, but you haven't spent... I mean, local authorities don't get exactly the same funding settlement. Is there some tensions around there that you can reveal to the committee today?
We have a management group for the regional park at which officers from all three authorities attend, and we discuss regularly the programme of works that we're doing. So, I would say that the concept of the park is that it's actually managed across local authority boundaries as an integrated area. And through the work of the management group and through the work of the joint committee, through the annual reporting that we have as well for our outputs on an annual basis for the budget that we have, I would say we make a pretty good job at managing it as a whole, and the output is reasonably fair across all local authority areas.
Thank you. Mr. Kinch?
Midlothian Council contributes in the region of about £60,000 annually to the Pentland Hills Ranger Service, or Pentland Heritage Service budget. And largely what Alan says is quite right. You know, the service is keeping its head above water in terms of the staff. I think what we all recognise is that what we call the infrastructure of the hills, i.e. the path system, is something that is very costly to maintain, and the budgets are not available for that at the moment. And we are looking at, between the local authorities, other mechanisms to be able to fund that. And that's an ongoing process just now. So that it tells you two things. One is that the service is doing a good job. But secondly, it does not have the budget and resources on between all the local authorities to fund all the pathworks that are required to keep to make the whole path network sustainable. And that's very, very costly. And we don't even quite know what that is going to cost yet over the next 5 years.
Right.
So maybe that brings some perspective to
Yeah, no, that's very helpful. Thank you, Mr. Muir.
Well, we have no budgets committed to the area of the extension at all. Over the past 5 or 6 years, I think we've dealt with a couple of minor rights-of-way issues, as we would do anywhere across the council area. We have assisted the Friends of the Pentlands with moving a footbridge about 4 or 5 years ago, and we helped them with a leaflet last year to the tune of £200. So apart from a small expenditure of staff time and the odd help to community groups, there's not much else.
Okay. Dartman?
In terms of the area itself, I think we've provided some information in terms of an estimate of the costings, which I think is something like equates to about £5,000 a year or thereabouts that we spend within that area in terms of core paths and promoting paths. Obviously, that is taken out of our wider budget for the whole of the borders, because obviously we're covering over 4,700 square kilometres of area with a long range of footpaths and such like that we maintain, and that the core team that we've got, which are five access rangers and two path wardens, provide support within that wider area and provide support on occasion in the park area. But there is no specific budget for that area. That is just taken from the broader budget that we have and is used as necessary. So that was a very broad estimate of what we think we have spent within that sort of area on an annual basis.
Thank you. My final question, convener, then, is if I can move on to the proposed extended park, what funding sources would be available to each of the witnesses for issues such as parking, signage and path resurfacing. I appreciate you would need to use some creative accounting perhaps to find some of that funding, but can I start with Mr. Alcorn as well?
As I mentioned earlier, it is just existing for West Lothian capital revenue, which has been agreed for the next 3 years. We're in year two, this is year two of the 3 year agreed cycle. So other than using the likes of Central Scotland Green Network Trust, who tend to do a lot of our green access type works, the issue with a lot of external funding is the match funding element of it, and the council is finding it increasingly difficult to find the match, be it 20-50%. So perhaps again, there's a number of community development trusts adjacent to the extension area, Kirk Newton Community Development Trust, West Calder Harbour and Community Development Trust, so they have access to funds, but we're not picking up at the moment that they are looking at this area in any degree. So as I say, the existing financial settlement which we have hasn't allocated any internal money towards this. And other than the likes of SRDP gets bandied around a lot of the time, but I believe, you know, it's only a million, only covers the whole of Scotland, and it takes officer time to apply for these external grants and then let alone manage them. And then, as I said, finding the match funding for it is increasingly difficult.
Give that. Mr. McGregor?
Yeah, just to mirror what Chris said there, SRDP potentially, it's available to land managers and now available to local authorities to an extent as well to carry out works on land, potentially Heritage Lottery Fund, potentially. However, these things are all related largely to capital works, perhaps for path improvements, access infrastructure, that type of thing. The challenge, both for the existing park and would apply also to an extended park, would be the bread and butter, day-in, day-out visitor management services, the management and upkeep of access points, car parks, information, visitor centres as appropriate, staff on the ground to actually advise visitors and deal with conflict resolution, dealing with farmers and landowners on issues they have with access on their land. All of that's very much bread and butter routine service provision, which is quite difficult to see how that would be provided other than a local authority revenue-funded service provision. Within the current climate, it's difficult to see how that might be extended at this stage. So I think there is important to see that distinction between potentially there's money out there for works on the ground on a project-by-project basis, but the ongoing bread-and-butter services, I think, does fall back to a revenue budget pressure for local authorities.
And if I understand these additional funding sources correctly, I mean, there's normally a matching element to be required, isn't there? And secondly, there would be an opportunity cost charge. In other words, you would have to allocate staff to go away and work out how to do the application. And if you're doing that, you're taking them away from other tasks. So there's two factors there, isn't there? There's matching and staff time to do these various applications.
Indeed, and the staff time is spent both on project management, as you just described, but also the actual provision of visitor management services on the ground and interaction with public and farmers and landowners. So, yeah.
Thank you. Mr. Kinch?
I think Alan's right. The second issue of revenue funding for ongoing maintenance management is a trick that would need to be sorted out, and I'm not quite sure how they'd address that. It would be probably the local authorities to my right that would need to do that. In terms of capital funding, I think that's probably a little bit more straightforward. I think, you know, the local authorities, if they if this bill goes through and they can work with the groups like the Friends of the Pentlands, and other organisations in order to get money. They're quite often funders are more likely to give funding to independent organisations and not local authorities. So that would be one of the ways I'd be looking for to get money into the Pentland Hills for car parks and improving the path system.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Muir?
Well, I can see no flexibility whatsoever in our existing core operational budgets within South Lanarkshire for this area of work. They're very, very small. We deliver a fairly extensive and I like to think quite innovative program that is largely based on supporting and empowering communities and other groups and developing partnerships with people like NHS Lanarkshire. So most of our operational delivery comes through these sorts of streams. We have nothing like that really focused on this area. As I said, it's very peripheral from what I would call our core populations in terms of health improvement. And while we're more than happy to continue to work with the Friends of the Pentlands on things like infrastructure improvement in the same way as we do with groups all over South Lanarkshire, I cannot see where any additional revenue funding would come for that area, and we would not see it as a priority.
I'll probably just echo what Malcolm's just said. I think from our perspective, our budgets are incredibly tight, and having spent most of yesterday going through further budget trimming, you know, there's a number of budgets, and obviously access is one which is vulnerable in many respects. We have, I say, a limited team that covers a wide area and lots of core paths and Scottish National Trail and the rest of it. We would have to be diverting scarce resources away from our key priorities and our key priority areas in terms of central borders, in terms of Berkshire coasts and such, where we have the pressures from population and access to an area which, again, is peripheral to us, where we don't see that there is the recreational need, the demand within that area in the border. So I would just echo what Malcolm said in his presentation.
Thank you, Convener.
Do you want to ask a supplementary to this, Convener? Just a very brief one. One or two of you have mentioned SRDP as a possible source of funding, understandably, so have others. But I just wondered if you can confirm that the amount of SRDP available through the improving public access pot, which I think is what we're probably talking about here, has actually been reduced from what it was and is now about 1.2 million a year, I think, over the next 5 years. Can that be confirmed by anybody? It can't be confirmed.
I'm not sure what it is, no.
Right, okay. Well, my understanding is that it's 1.2 well, it averages out at 1.2 million a year over 5 years for the improving public access pot, which is what I think we're looking at. So it is. It would be useful to find out, I think, because if it is a reducing amount, it clearly adds to some of the pressure. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Alec, you've got a question.
Yes, I think it's probably almost been answered, but we're talking about revenue costs. Has anybody done an estimate of what the increased revenue costs would be if the park were to be increased in size? And if not, could the cost be met from existing budgets? And I think I know the answer to that one already.
It's my understanding that detailed estimation of what additional revenue costs might accrue has not been carried out, and I think that is, speaking from City of Edinburgh Council's perspective, makes it quite difficult to accurately assess the likely financial impact. I think there perhaps is a requirement for a little bit more detailed detailed investigatory work looking at what level of service provision might be envisaged for an extended regional park, and then building up from that you'd start to be able to estimate the likely revenue required to provide those services. To date that work hasn't been carried out.
As far as that is one of the concerns that we've raised in representations in terms of the lack of clarity in terms of the park itself and how it's delivering and its issues in terms of the financial position, its organisation, its governance and such like, how that then translates to an extended area. So our view is that there needs to be significant work in terms of looking at the park, looking at the extended park before we can actually get to a position where actually we know what the implications are going to be. So from our point of view, we don't think there is that clarity there to enable us to support it.
Does anybody else want to comment?
Yes, I would agree with that. Again, we found nothing in the financial memorandum that would actually allow us to make reasonably accurate predictions.
And the second part of my question, which, I mean, I think you've already given us a picture that the current budget is pretty well stretched in terms of providing the objectives that you're required to do. So I take it the second part of my question is it basically could not be covered out of current cost.
Certainly budget. Not within existing budgets, no.
Okay, thank you very much.
Could I just ask Mr. Aikman further to his response there and to the points you made in his objection? You talked about the future staffing costs. Could you maybe give us a wee bit more detail about what you think those staffing costs might be to the council?
I think that's where we're saying that we don't have the clarity as to what the nature of the proposal is in terms of the organisation, what the staffing costs will be, what are the implications of the proposal, and that's why we're raising raising concerns. We have a small team. As I've mentioned, we have five access rangers and two wardens, and we have a budget for the whole of the borders of £409,000, of which £236,000 is our staffing costs. So there's a limited spend budget to do that. We've obviously got a large area to deal with a lot of miles and kilometres of footpath. So we don't, at the moment, until we know what the potential implications are, we can't make an assessment as to whether we can deal with that in terms of our existing budget. And indeed, as I've sort of highlighted, even our existing budgets are likely to be trimmed through the next year. You know, we're looking at sort of year 1 to 5 planning over the next, and there are significant cuts coming our way. So the, you know, our view is that we don't have enough information to make the assessment as to whether we can deal with it in existing facility with our existing budgets. And, you know, as we go on over the next 5 years, that budget's going to be reducing again. So what are the, you know, the additional pressures that this may bring? So, we, again, it's just going back to the point, we have a lack of clarity.
Do you have any idea or any feel for what sort of extra services you may be asked to provide if this extension goes ahead?
Well, there's reference to a warden, but is that what you, in the submissions and the papers? But we don't, you know, again, until you know what the organisation will be, what are we expecting from it, until you've actually had a detailed analysis, as I've mentioned before, of the proposal and how it is going to work, I don't think you can actually come to that. You can come to that conclusion. You'd be making a guess, essentially, as to what it would be.
Right. Thanks very much for that. One of the suggestions had been the possibility of moving to a trust model. Would the members of the panel like to give me their views on whether a trust model might work for the extended park in terms of both governance and helping relieve financial pressures? Mr. Muir.
Again, we need to know where the core funding for the trust was going to come from, because exactly the same principles apply, really. And there's usually with these trusts an expectation that the local authorities are core funders to some extent, and there is no money.
Okay. Does anybody else have a differing view? Mr. McGregor, you look.
Not a different view. It's really just to reiterate that there was a meeting of the existing Pentland Hills Regional Park Joint Committee in January of last year to address this issue, and we had some input from Scottish Natural Heritage and others looking at what sort of models operate to provide similar services elsewhere, and a discussion was held around how that might translate to the regional park and how it might translate to an extended regional park. The consensus at this stage is that while there are potentially some benefits from a trust-type model, it does require local authority core funding, typically. And the issue about providing revenue-funded services on the ground, again, remains a challenge, whereas a trust-based approach may be quite good at bringing in external funding from other sources that are not necessarily available to local authorities for infrastructure works on the ground. The day-in, day-out visitor management services tend to be, again, revenue-funded, and difficult to sustain that on a longer term basis with a trust model. One of the outputs from those discussions, however, was, and it's a project just now that we're looking to try and get off the ground, which is to work with existing trusts to actually increase the amount of work that we're doing on some of the footpaths and the access infrastructure in the Pentland Hills. So we're looking at working with Edinburgh and Lothian's Greenspace Trust, potentially Cair and Gorm's Outdoor Access Trust, to try and get a project off the ground to raise funds and deliver upland footpath improvements and lever out investment in that in a way that we've not been able to do before. Now, the model there is not setting up a new trust bespoke to the regional park, but actually to work more constructively with existing trusts, leaning on what they are good at to actually provide improvements on the ground. So that's one example of how working with a trust-type model may work. The feeling at this stage, however, is that to provide the whole integrated management of a regional park, either existing or extended, on a trust-based model is unlikely to be effective in the longer term.
Okay, thanks very much. Does anybody else have any comment to make on that? If not, then my last question is a pretty straightforward one. Can I ask each of you in turn if you would support the bill if there was no additional funding available? Mr. Aikman?
There's no funding available, no.
Mr. Muir?
No.
Mr. Kinch?
Need to get approval, but from the council, but I can't see at the moment without extra funding we would go ahead with it, want to go ahead with it. Yeah.
Mr. McGregor.
No. However, the caveat would be, where would that additional funding come from? And there may be further work needed to explore where that additional funding may come from, whether it's from Scottish Government, whether it's through other sources. But the answer to the question is no. Without additional funding, no, we'd be unable to support it.
Thank you. Mr. Alcorn.
And similarly, the position I mean at the moment, it's not been in the next initial short-term plan for financially. It's not an existing financial strategy, so there's not support at this stage.
Thank you very much. Christine, would you like to ask?
Yeah, yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much, gentlemen. I'm going to go back to the bill itself. And the bill has one simple aim. I ask you if you would agree with this, that it's simply to extend the boundary of the Pentland Hills Regional Park, and does it on road outlines or subject later, if local authorities wanted to tweak it over 2 years. That's all the bill does. Would you agree? It simply extends the boundary. I can't see anything in here about local authorities having to pay anything, about management. It just extends the boundary. It
extends the boundary, but then what does that achieve?
Thank you for that. That's a good point. And so my point is from something, if I go to you, Mr. Aikman, that you said, is you said the designation, I think I'm paraphrasing, and it was also said by South Lancashire, would make no difference. Well, so it's neutral in terms of just moving it. If it makes no difference to what you're already doing.
If it would be a line on the map. If,
yes.
If there's no governance, if there's no, if there is no, provision to actually deliver anything. If you just think it's a line on the map, it's a line on the map.
That's
but
it.
In many
exactly.
cases, what is the point of that?
Can I put this to you as well, that although it's simply a line on the map, it takes us to all this interesting debate, and there's part of it, but it's tangential to what this does about the additional funding if local authorities were required to do something. Would you agree with me at the moment that the arrangement between the existing local authorities is contractual?
Yes, it is. It's expressed through a minute of agreement.
So that anything, if this bill were to succeed, and given that it's got a two-year period of running, if it gets royal assent, in that period, although it's not the purpose of the bill, just extending the line, it would be possible for local authorities and others to negotiate, to discuss and so on, and to come to other contractual arrangements amongst themselves, or indeed with other organisations and charities. It's possible. You'd agree. If nothing happened in that period, then nothing's gained and nothing's lost. We've just put a line on the map. Is that correct?
You have put a line on the map, yes.
Right. So my point I'm making about this is that this debate is very interesting about the additional funding. And of course, I'm interested and I've attended many meetings about additional funding. But we've got a Pentland Hills Regional Park, which isn't the Pentland Hills Regional Park because it doesn't take in the whole range. So first of all, by doing this, we'd bring in the entire range and we'd put that line in the map. And what I'm trying to ask you, gentlemen, is that I see this as an enabling bill. It sets out a format, sets out a boundary for you within which, if you are minded, and I'm absolutely aware of the difficulties of budgets across local authorities, focus can be put on how this can be managed, the northern part and the southern part. But what I'm asking of you, gentlemen, is to look at the bill just as it is, and you say, I would oppose this. That's what I'm hearing from you. There's no funding. Well, you're opposing a line on a map. And if it's just a line on the map, why oppose it?
If you put a line on the map, there's a public expectation that something will be delivered. And obviously, at present, if the bill doesn't go through, local authorities could come to the same arrangements and actually promote it if they felt there was a need to do so. So I think from our point of view, saying, unless you go through that exercise of...
Two councillors to my left. It says in the policy objective of the bill that it's about the long term, it would be guided by the regional park principal aims. Would that mean then that there would be more responsibility on the two councils who just now have limited or no responsibility, and would that therefore bring with it an extra cost?
I think there's the potential, and again, I have to say at this stage it's potential because we don't have clarity as to what the implications of that would be, but there is certainly potential for that, yes.
Mr. Muir?
I mean, I take the point, but any form of boundary or any form of designation does generate some sort of expectation among actual and potential users, and just as importantly, among those who manage the land in the area, as to the level of infrastructure and the quality of infrastructure that will be put in place. At present, I could not see us being in a position to commit to landowners to maintain the sorts of infrastructure that they discuss in their responses to this paper.
I'm looking at the actual cost because I want to get to it. Because it is the bill we're just discussing, nothing else, not how it's managed later, anything else. And on the actual costs of the boundary being changed, it's pretty well peanuts. It's very low amounts of 2,000. You mentioned possibilities of wardens, possibilities of car parks in the financial memorandum, but they are just possibilities. The actual cost would simply be information to the public. Is that not correct? I mean, I'm actually asking, you're here on the evidence on the bill, and that's it. Boundary change, what would it cost you? That's it. All the other stuff, which is very important and very interesting, actually is not pertinent to this bill. There's nothing in here that says you have to set up another management arrangement. There's nothing in here that says that you have to come to some contractor. There's nothing that compels local authorities to do anything other than they're doing just now. It simply puts the line on the map. And that's why I'm concerned that what we're not discussing is this bill.
Just reflect that the position with the existing regional park and the underlying legislation is as you describe it. It doesn't actually provide any duties on local authorities to do anything, but it provides powers under which integrated management can be provided. So I agree there's a range of levels to which additional services may or may not be provided and what they may cost at a later stage. And so I agree there's a discretionary and as to the level of input that might be required at a later stage.
You see, I'm interested that, I mean, give me a sort of... I'm trying to find a polite word, Mr. Aikman. I'm trying to get to the point of this, of saying to you, I appreciate your concerns, all of you. I appreciate funding difficulties. That's why the bill is drafted as it is. That's why it doesn't make any compulsion on local authorities to do anything. That's why it doesn't have anything about touching on management. That's why it's simply a line on the map, enabling over a course of 2 years, if it can be achieved, a different management setup and to encompass the entire range. If that doesn't take place and the bill has passed, it'll still be a regional park, but there's no compulsion on local authorities. So I allay your fears, gentlemen, that you're suddenly going to have these demands made upon you, because it'd have to be consensual amongst you all.
Be at present, though I think that that's the point. It can be if we in our communities feel there's a desire, need, a pressure for this type of facility, we can come together to do that. And there has not been that desire or the need to do this. So, from our point of view, you say there is no need to put the line on the map in the first place.
With respect, the communities necessarily go to the planning office to tell them they've got an interest in things. They've come to me about it. And, you know, people like the West Linton Ramblers, and in fact, by taking your part of the world in Carlops, it puts itself as the gateway to the Pentlands, so there are advantages to it.
And they can do that already through the promoted paths that they have.
Thank you.
Love that.
Okay. Do you have any more questions, Christine?
Well, I would hope that the gentleman would agree with me that it's simply a line on the map and the costs are as designated in the financial memorandum and that all the other issues are extraneous to this particular bill. And I would ask them to answer that one by one, as you did, if I may, convener.
But the question is, I think, as thoroughly as I can.
So the other funding things are extraneous to this bill?
No, I say, in terms of the response of it I've already made, I'll stand by the response that I've made.
Can I just say that I'm not convinced that the witnesses can answer that question completely, because we are getting some information that says that there would be financial commitments by it being regional park. I'd rather look into that before I ask witnesses to commit themselves to something that might be
erroneous.
I beg your pardon, Convener. I'm just asking, is that the financial memorandum that's being challenged?
We've got a briefing here that says it. But we'll discuss that at a later date.
Rather take me aback, as I've never had this raised with me previously.
Okay. Thank you. Colin, have you got any questions for the witnesses?
Thanks for that, Convener. And I think, first of all, just to explain the reasoning for me being here is... Between 2007 and 2012, I was a member of the Pentland Hills Regional Park Management Committee. And from 2010 to 12, I was in fact the convener of that committee. And I'm here really in the background that I have. And I have to say that I'm a little bit disappointed in the way things are. Going back, I would sort of ask Mr. McGregor, who I was my lead officer at that point, if he could confirm that what we were looking at with the certainly declining funds, but also the representation of the regional park as not being a full range, was certainly prevalent amongst those visitors who were visiting the park. And also the fact that the relationships that were built within the park is a living, breathing organism, not just in terms of the visitor numbers and those people using the park for that purpose of recreation. Certainly in terms of the management of the park over the years grew to be a large success. And if you could confirm it, I would take me on to a second question after that.
The park was originally designated back in the days of the regional councils. The concept was always to include the entire hill range, because as a landscape feature, it's an integrated landscape feature, the entire hill range, and also the way in which people enjoy recreation in the Pentland Hills looks at the whole hill range. People use the whole hill range as things stand. It has different characteristics, north and south. People enjoy recreation in different ways and with different levels of intensity. But the entire hill range is an integrated landscape feature, and a place where people visit was always the kind of concept. And the discussions that we had around what we've provided within the existing park boundary and some of those benefits, they could accrue to the entire hill range, and there would be merits in that. That's putting to one side everything we've said about where local authorities are just now in terms of funding pressures and budget and what we can and can't do. But as a concept, a regional park covering the entire hill range has many merits, yes, and I think that continues to be the case, notwithstanding the pressures that local authorities find themselves under in terms of service provision.
So could you perhaps agree with me, and perhaps the others may wish to comment, that given the, as has been pointed out by everyone, there is an acceptance of strains on local authority budgets, that this bill actually may give us the opportunity as a stay in order that we could indeed find the option of the correct management model to take this on further, because my fear is that if we lose this, the old pressures of those people coming to the park as visitors and those people who work in the park in terms of business, those old strains and stresses will come together. And I know that in the park that we dealt with, we had not just the farmers, the visitors, but we also had the Ministry of Defence. And you have all these different pressures that just a management function on a light touch, working with a consensus, a consensual fashion, has proved highly successful, and we should really give ourselves time to find this new model, therefore trying to take the strains off local authorities.
Clearly, from a managing authority, City of Edinburgh Council's managing authority for the existing park, I couldn't say with confidence whether that is or isn't achievable in terms of a negotiated position with the five local authorities about providing service. However, certainly what we could do is contribute positively with reference to the 27 years of experience within the existing park, which has a track record. It's been there's been successes, there's been some challenges, but there is a track record there to show what a regional park can deliver within the existing boundary. And some of those lessons could usefully be applied to providing service across a bigger boundary, and would be very happy to contribute positively to those discussions. However, City of Edinburgh Council as a lead authority doesn't have a locus by itself to influence the outcome of that. Clearly, that would be a matter for negotiation at a later stage.
So just going back to the final point, or really is the first point, does this bill not give us that leeway to try and find a new model that can be found in that time? Consensually, I would ask everybody, having heard what we've heard.
So I still feel in many ways in the dark about, in terms of issues, be it on access, biodiversity, habitat, whatever, in the extended area, and the staff and revenue and capital consequences from that. So it's a bit like voting for Christmas, turkeys voting for Christmas, and not completely clear what those issues would be. And going into a new territory of a trust, it ain't broke, it doesn't seem to be broken at the moment, don't fix it. Concerned that local authorities through the trust model may then lose involvement in that trust. A number of trusts we've seen have struggled, a number of trusts in these sorts of environmental issues have struggled to retain staff and struggled to provide services in these times.
The points that have already been made.
Who else wants to comment and to respond to Mr. Keir? Mr. McGregor?
I think the answer would be it may, but there are. It has the potential to do that, but I think we have to have reference to the position that we find ourselves in at this stage, but it may.
Just as a final thing, convener, I would just say that this, in my opinion, this time is required simply to hold the discussions to see if this is possible, and the line in the map aspect that comes across is perfectly valid. And I think my views are quite clear. I think it's worth preserving and looking for an option that could take this forward.
Okay, thanks, Colin. You've made your position very clear. Alec, you want to come in with a supplementary?
If I may, convener, thank you. And I admire Christine Graham's tenacity and reasoning in trying to find time to look at a different model. But the only different model I've heard being suggested is a trust model. And I have some knowledge of trusts, but I'm no expert. But I wonder if anybody can tell me a trust model, and if you take local authority funding out of it, that still doesn't depend very heavily on publicly funded bodies, SNH, Forestry Commission, Visit Scotland. Can anybody highlight an example that doesn't depend heavily on the public purse? Not solely, but heavily, particularly for revenue funding. Because I'm not aware of any, and I just wondered if you are with your experience, because I do think that has some bearing on what we're looking at. But thank you for that.
Thank you. I've got just one last question for Mr. McGregor, and kind of comes from the question by Conkier. Could you give us an indication of the actions that have been taken over the last 27 years and speculate about whether similar ones would follow in a new area if there was an extended park?
The starting point, as I understand it, for the suggestion that the regional park should be set up back in the... It goes back to the 1970s. That's when the process started. And the starting point was it was a landscape that people came out and visited in numbers. People were looking to enjoy the Pentland Hills. And that in itself was creating opportunities, but some pressures. It's largely a farming environment, urban fringe, particularly near to the Edinburgh area. and there were issues that actually needed to be managed. And that very much sort of drove the initial designation of the park. There was something to be managed. There was opportunities, and there was pressures to manage. And looking at an extended park down into the borders in South Lanarkshire, those pressures would be quite different, and they'd be sensitive to what the opportunities and where the pressures are. I think it's fair to recognise that some areas are under greater pressure and are visited more heavily. Other areas of the Pentland Hills are much quieter, have a very different character to them, and that would need to be respected in terms of the week.
Could you just clarify for me then, when the regional park came into being then, was there actions you had to take because you became regional park? Because of the expectation that was put on you about becoming a regional park?
Yes, at that stage it was very much about providing management, a level of management services, visitor and countryside management services. And at the time it was the Countryside Commission for Scotland that funded the regional park fairly heavily. And that carried on through to Scottish Natural Heritage funding as well up till relatively recently. So the expectation was not just to create a designation for a designation's sake, but it's about public recreational enjoyment of that upland landscape, and the expectation was very much that services are provided to enable that, to enable public enjoyment, but also to provide support for the farming and landowning community who live and work in the hills, and to integrate the two together, and that was very much the ethos. So it's about service provision, and the boundary and the park designation was a precursor to enabling that service provision. So they do go hand in hand.
Okay, thanks very much. We're now coming to the end of our session, so I'd like to thank the witnesses very much for their time this morning and for their full responses, and I now close the session for 5 minutes to allow the next panel to suspend the session for five
minutes.
Thank
you very much.
Thank you.
back into session. Can I welcome the second panel representing the key stakeholder organisations? We've got in front of us Robert Barr from the National Farmers Union of Scotland, Anne Grade, Policy Officer Environment, Scottish Land and Estates, Janice Winning, Operations Manager, Scottish National Heritage, and Helen Todd, the Campaigns and Policy Manager, Ramblers Scotland. I'd like to start off by asking the same first question of this panel as I did of the last. Are you aware of any demand for an extension to the Pentland Hills Regional Park? Helen Todd, could I start with you? Janice Winning?
No, not in the southern part of the park, although we are aware that there are some pressures at particular times of year in the existing park at honeypot sites, and also pressures for events throughout the year.
Okay, thank you. Scree?
No, we're not aware of any demand at all. No one's come to us expressing demand for an extension of the park.
Mr. Barr?
We see no demand for the park at all, and from the farming point of view, vehemently opposed to extending it.
Okay, thank you very much. Well, my next question has already been answered by yourself, Mr. Barr, but it's to ask if you think an extension to the park is needed to help meet aims such as protecting the landscape, encouraging access, coordinating multiple uses of the land in the areas currently outside the park. Do you want to come back in on that, Mr. Barr?
I just feel that the park at the moment, the management has dropped off very significantly over the years. You know, the education that we used to do has all dropped off, and without that, I don't think we should be looking at extending the park. I feel very much that if you designate the park, as Christine mentioned earlier on, put a line on the map, that will encourage people to go there, therefore increasing a need. And if we haven't got funding to comply with that and to work with that, it's going to cause more bother for all the land managers in the area.
Can I just ask you a question about anticipated additional revenue costs if the park was extended? Do you have a view on this? I don't know if you heard the previous panel's answers.
Yes, we've got a very, very strong view, in that, as I've already mentioned, the funding for the original park has been depleted over the years, and we see the services getting depleted along with it as the need for the service grows by the increased number of people coming. And we feel there should be a feasibility study to show where the funding is coming from, because it's obviously not coming from councils.
You mentioned this in your objection as an individual as well, didn't you?
This
point of view. Okay, thank you very much. Ms. Gray?
We don't see how the objectives you mentioned, so I think you talked about protecting the landscape, encouraging access, and coordinating different land uses. And in this context, I presume we're talking about the potential conflict between access takers and existing land management. Don't see how any of that will really be achieved simply by extending the boundary, simply by creating a new line on a map. To achieve any of those things would require resources, funding, management. It's difficult to see how the bill would achieve what it aims to achieve without looking at the funding model.
Okay, thanks very much. Ms. Money?
You mentioned, is the extension necessary for landscape protection and allowing for recreational opportunities? I don't think it's necessary, because there are existing policies in place which allow for landscape protection and for enjoyment of the hills and enjoyment of the natural heritage. I think what we stated in our consultation response was that there were opportunities for more, for slightly more landscape protection, slightly more opportunities for managing the whole of the Pentland Hills range for nature and for people and for recreational enjoyment, and having that land area managed. But those opportunities could only be recognised really with full local authority support and stakeholder buy-in. And from the consultation responses, it's quite obvious that we don't have those final elements.
Can I ask you to explain the legislative protections that are in place already?
The protection is through the local authority planning policies, through their landscape designations to protect the Pentland Hills, the area of the Pentland Hills, and also,
Right, thank you very much.
And natural heritage designations that are again protected through local authority planning policies.
Thank you. Ms. Todd?
Okay, I gave a fairly blunt answer before saying no, we hadn't come across any particular desire from our members and others to extend the park, but we started from the position of the principle of the landscape as it is, and we're very much involved in the Cairngorm National Park extension into Highland Perthshire, and as you'll recall the geographic extent of the Cairngorms was sort of severed by a political boundary, and that's the principle we've taken here, that if you was to start from scratch looking at a Pentland Hills Regional Park, you would look at the whole hills as a concept, and as Alan said earlier, there is a merit in that. There's been a lot of talk about visitor management, visitor pressures, but actually you could flip that around and say what opportunities there are. There are obviously lots of people at one end of the park, not so many visiting the others. And as well as the pressures and the management that requires, it also brings a lot of economic benefit to businesses around that area that could be spread further, in our view, down to the other end of the park. So where pressures might be seen as bad news, or we have to repair the paths, we have to make sure that people are managed, and of course there are land use concerns there, these are also opportunities as well. And I just wanted to refer to one of the studies that was mentioned in the papers for this meeting, that the council had done a study about the social return on investment, because it wasn't mentioned earlier that for every pound they put into the Pentland Hills Regional Park, they get up to £13 in return on social investment. So that means the health benefits that people get, the volunteering skills that people learn, and so forth. So these are not inconsequential benefits that could be spread to other parts of the park.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. I think Helen Todd's just touched on my question, which was that Ramblers Scotland have said that in the longer term, economic opportunities will open up to businesses in the new section of the park, and this will offset any additional funding required in the short term. Can I ask what the other witnesses think about that statement? Could I start with yourself, Mr. Barr?
Yes, if you just look round the park at the moment as it stands, I think you'll find that there's very few businesses that have actually jumped on the bandwagon and used the park as their means of business. I think Swanson's about the only one that's using that. All the rest are, there are numerous pubs that were around the area and they've all closed. I think there's only one left, that two maybe are on the periphery.
Yeah. Thank you for that. Angry?
I think there's a bit of a mismatch in the Rambler statement in what they're suggesting, in as much as it will be private businesses that potentially accrue benefits if those opportunities are there to be had, but to manage the park requires public funding input. So it's yes, fine, that increased investment may provide some business opportunities and maybe offset in other ways, but we still need to find that investment, and it doesn't appear to be there at the moment. I think the other thing is that there's nothing particularly stopping people taking advantage, business advantage, of the southern part of the Pentlands Regional Park at the moment if they want to. outdoor recreation businesses could be using that area. Some will be, but it's not clear that by bringing that area within a regional park that alone, that in itself, would create additional opportunity. I think those opportunities are about location, about accessibility, about the types of activity people want to carry out in that area. And if that demand existed, I can't help but feeling that that it would already be happening. There's no huge barrier to that happening at the moment.
If that, Janice Winning?
I think that there might be some small opportunities for rural economic development and businesses based on tourism, but they probably would be relatively small scale and perhaps limited to certain communities like West Linton, who happen to be more of a gateway to that southern part of the park. There is a model elsewhere in Scotland, the Loch Lomond Trossachs Countryside Trust, where businesses within the national park can voluntarily provide income for the actual running of the park. And I suppose that's the sort of business model which we would like to see, you know, contribute to the wider infrastructure and things. But it would require many businesses to reach the revenues that are required.
Thank you for that. I'll move on to my second question to give Helen Todd a speaking part. You mentioned in your submission about the importance of a trust model and how that might work in an extended Pentland Hill Regional Park. Could you explain to the committee how you see the trust model working?
Yeah, well, actually, I don't think I have anything else to add from what was discussed earlier, because as certainly Alan McGregor was saying, that has already lots of different models have been discussed within the joint committee already. I just know that we don't have expertise in this, I'll be quite frank, but I do know from seeing the Upper Deeside Access Trust become the Cairngorms Outdoor Access Trust, and as Janice mentioned, the Loch Lomond Trust starting up. This is more and more a model for getting access management funded. We're seeing it throughout Scotland. And just to add to that, at the moment there isn't very much recreation taking part in the extended area of the park. That's absolutely true. I've tried all over the place to look for examples of where I could go for a walk. There really aren't that many promoted routes. I think there would be a real potential for this discussion and an extended boundary to add to the opportunities for promoting that area a lot more and making the communities in that area think, oh gosh, you know, how can we get people to come here? It's a really nice place. Where can they go for a walk? Because it's not just about building paths. It's actually telling people what's there already. And I don't think it's well known what's there already.
I mean, notwithstanding your comments about the trust model, I mean, do you think the trust model in any way would help with costs? Because obviously that is a key aspect of our earlier discussions.
Yeah, because there's a lot of different funding sources out there, and obviously the focus is so much on local government and national government and what can be provided centrally, but there are a lot of other funds. I mean, just to take an example, the Pentland Hills is absolutely teeming with cultural heritage, and so the Heritage Lottery Fund might be an example of... I mean, nothing is easy and it all takes staff time, I recognise that, but... I'm on the Scottish Outdoor Access Network committee, as is Anne, and we recently had an event looking at different funding sources and the wide range of opportunities there that local authorities, working in partnership with communities and others, can tap into is growing, I would say.
Thank you. I'm just going to ask the other panel members then about what their view is of the trust model. Going to start with Janice Winning.
Yes, SNH gave advice to the Joint Committee, and we talked about the different trust models around Scotland and the pros and cons, and there are cons for different... There are pros and cons for different models. And I think the conclusion from the Joint Committee was that to set up another trust would actually clutter the landscape, as it were, of the trusts that are already operating within the Pentland Hills. We have the Edinburgh and Lothian's Greenspace Trust and the Central Scotland Green Network Trust and the Friends of the Pentlands, all who are able to access external funding and carry out projects on behalf of the landowners and behalf of visitor management in the park. So to have another trust layered on top of that, which competes for funds, might not be the best best use of time and money, and that we would be better working with the existing trust to deliver some of the projects that we wanted. And hence, SNH has put money up front to say that we're willing to help fund a path development project taken forward by Edinburgh and Lothian's Greenspace Trust with advice from Cairngorm's Outdoor Access Trust.
I think you've partly answered the question I was going to ask you, which was the obvious point. Could you then ask the existing trust to have an extended role on the extended park so they could access other money funds through their trust role?
Yes, I think that is a possibility. And in fact, the Friends of the Pentlands operate across the Pentland Hills fully at the moment, yes.
Instead of creating something new, we can use the good skills we've already got with the good work carried out by existing trusts.
Yes.
Right, that's very useful. Thank you. Anne Gray?
I'm not an expert on trusts, but I'm certainly aware of other ones that have operated fairly successfully throughout Scotland. The Cairngorms Outdoor Access Trust is an example of one of the better ones. There's others have struggled and haven't quite got their model right. But on the whole, I think it's a valid thing to look at. My slight concern, hesitation with trusts is that the revenue funding for them tends to still come from some element of the Scottish public purse, and the Scottish public purse across the board is under pressure and has been squeezed. So it'd be interesting to see how even existing trusts cope with that pressure from main funders. They're certainly successful at levering in capital funding and at match funding capital funding. But that requires the basis of staff and offices and all the revenue funding that sits under that to make that pulling together capital funding work. No harm in looking at it, certainly within the existing park, but I think it feels a little bit cart before the horse to look at extending the boundary before we've explored how it can be funded. Trust model certainly could be one option, but we'd want to see that work done and to be confident about it before the extension was put in place. And I think certainly it should be looked at in the existing park and explored there before we look at the idea of it applying to an extension.
Thanks for that. That's very helpful. Mr. Barr?
I don't know an awful lot about trust, I'm afraid, but what I do see is trying to get funding for what we have at the moment, and I know the Friends of the Pentlands, I know a lot of them quite personally. They're lovely people, they do a great job, but they struggle to get volunteers to do administrative work at the moment, and how would they go if they were handling an awful lot more money? The other point I'd like to make is that the Pentland Hills sits and looks over a good part of the financial district of Edinburgh, and there's never been very much money forthcoming from there for any of the projects in the past, and I can't see that changing in the future.
So we shouldn't start calling the Royal Bank of Scotland National Park or Standard Life National Park?
I sit and watch the money they're spending from my house.
No, I think on that note, I better hand back to the convener.
I wish you'd handed back a couple of seconds. ask Alex a question.
Yeah, moving on to a slightly sort of different topic, I think you all heard the previous session and a number, if not all of the witnesses, said it was quite difficult to answer some of the questions because of the lack of detail and further knowledge of what would be involved and all of that type of thing. And indeed, in I think it was West Lothian, in their submission, highlighted the need for basically what amounts to a feasibility study to, if this was to go ahead, to look into the ins and outs, pros, cons, and all the rest of it. And many people said that SNH was probably best placed to... sorry, not many people, West Lothian, let me be precise, suggested that SNH was the best placed body to carry out that study. So can I ask what your view of that is, whether there has been any initial work done on the feasibility, including the financial feasibility of a park, and where SNH stands on this, if I could.
Yes, we're aware of that call for SNH to carry out a study. Without full local authority support, it would be it wouldn't be right for SNH to carry out work that didn't have the support from all of the local authorities for taking forward the park. And that really became apparent from the responses to the consultation. Instead, what we tried to do was focus on the financial security and management of the existing park, and that's why we looked at the trust, the models of different trust arrangements. So instead of feasibility, we were looking more at security of funding, looking at the existing park and to see whether a funding mechanism could be found that also then could roll out to an existing park in future years, should that be the case. So and also again looking instead of a feasibility on it's difficult to know what resources would be required because of the demand. So again, that would require visitor studies, and we don't have funding for that or the resources to do that at the moment within SNH or within the park, because in order to work out the costs, we'd need to work out what the demands and facilities might be. So it's a very difficult thing. So we've moved away from feasibility more to sound sort of financial management and money for projects, really.
I hear exactly what you're saying, and forgive this question, it's born out of ignorance on my part. If there were to be a feasibility study, who would initiate that? Where would the original call come from for that?
I think it would come jointly from all the local authorities who were involved, and they would be putting the finance behind it as well.
They'd be putting the finance, but I say no more. Thank you. Sorry, I don't mean to be flippant, and that maybe sounded a bit flippant. What you're saying is that you have concentrated so far not so much on feasibility studies as how the existing park can be made to work better, and if necessary, if the security for that can be put in place, possibly extending it thereafter. Is that a fair
correct
summary?
That's correct, yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mike? Thank you, convener. Representing the Highlands and Islands, I get a number of letters from constituents, farmers, crofters, concerned about issues of conflict between them and walkers and people using the countryside in a recreational sense. And when there's a particular case that comes to mind from a crofter on the island of Iona who was driven mad. I must see you're nodding your head. You know, the first thought that occurs to me is ask the question about any conflicts that have arisen in the park over the last 20-odd years, is that, you know, these issues are not unique to parks, but I just wonder, you know, what conflicts there have been in the park to date, what is that implied in terms of management and resolution of the conflict or of any of these conflicts, and what are the implications in terms of conflict for extending the boundary? Just bearing in mind, though, that, you know, this may not be unique to this park in this situation.
I haven't got enough time to go through all the conflicts, but Christine will tell you she's been up to visit, and I would extend the invitation if anybody wants to come up and see the park. We can show them round and show them a lot of the conflicts. I'll just list a few. My main one, and I'm right on the doorstep of Collington, which is there's a lot of dog walkers use the hills below and above the park designation line. So we have a terrible amount of sheep being worried by dogs. Just this week I had one sheep chased into Torduff Reservoir with a dog which was totally out of control. By the time I got there, dog in person had gone, and reporting these matters to the police, I've been moaned at and told I should report every case to get the statistics up, but you know, you couldn't do it; it would just take too long. The other areas of conflict are the uses of the park. The honeypots have been mentioned already, and on a glorious Sunday during the summer, trying to get a combine or a tractor past some of the parked cars in the area is just nigh impossible. The other problem I see is that I find the people that use the park have changed over the years. You know, you go back to the late 70s, early 80s, when I was a young boy in the farm, the amount of people that were walking in the hills were usually bird watchers or just people out for a walk. They all knew, they didn't need a countryside access code. They knew the code of conduct, and they were more helpful than anything else. But these people have moved, and they're probably in the part of the that we're wanting to extend the park into. They've probably moved there for a bit of peace and quiet. But I find the people that are coming now are more cyclists, horse riders, families out for a walk just in the countryside. And it's through ignorance we get the problems. People climbing fences, dikes, and the small amount of damage they cause, it mounts up over the times. So these are a very few of our problems.
Thank you. Any other witnesses get any comments?
Yeah, I think the areas of conflict tend to be the areas that you see right across Scotland. So, you know, it's things like gates not being left as they were found, dogs, whether that's dog fouling or worrying sheep, littering, gates blocked. And the more people you have recreating in an area, the more you see these types of pressures. In areas where you've not got the same pressure, they tend to be less obvious. Certainly in the existing regional park, I think the Ranger Service has been instrumental in managing those conflicts. And it's not just the Ranger Service, but the Ranger Service can help put infrastructure in place that helps with the management. So whether it's dog poo bins, whether it's better paths, and people tend to, once they're on a path, stick to a path and wander less, whether it's information about existing land management, about not letting your dog worry sheep, all that kind of understanding, education and infrastructure can be built up and put in place by a decent ranger service. Now, the existing ranger service has come under pressure and diminished a bit in recent years, and that's a great shame. I think in the extension area, it remains to be seen the type of pressure that would exist in that extension area. Certainly, if one of the aims is to encourage access and active efforts put into that, you would expect more people, and therefore you would also need a ranger service and facilities in that extended area. So I think if you saw the type of increase that you might expect in recreational activity in an extended park, that needs to be accompanied by something that helps to manage that pressure.
Thank you. Any other witnesses?
I think it's already been said by Anne, but I'd like to repeat that the Natural Heritage Service within the park provides an excellent mechanism by, you know, to manage the conflicts between different user groups and recreational pressures on land management activities, and they do that through advice and information and lots of promotion, and they're doing a really good job at that.
Can I just follow up then briefly on that, though? Because if they are doing a very good job, why then does Mr. Barr have the concerns that he's expressed a few minutes ago?
Well, there will be incidences, the odd incident, you know, which escapes the ranger activity. But hopefully over time they will become less, not more. That would be a question for the regional park to answer, but I'm not aware that the pressures are increasing.
As I understand what Mr. Barr just said, that, you know, from his perspective, the pressures have increased over the years. That was my interpretation of what he said. And, you know, I'm bound to take those concerns seriously. And, you know, I'm not doubting anybody's intent. And I'm sure everybody has excellent intentions. But what I'm interested in is what can we learn about... And I think there's an inevitability about those pressures. People wish to use the countryside more. We're going to see this increasing... you know, whatever Mr. Barr may feel about it, those pressures are not going away. Given that we're all here, given that we're discussing this subject, is there anything new that any of the witnesses can bring to the table in terms of how we manage these pressures better? And, you know, what opportunities does this bill present in terms of shedding light on our understanding of how to do that?
There is perhaps nothing new that can be done. This is not something that's obviously just an issue in the Pentland Hills Regional Park, as you mentioned. It's widespread across Scotland. And yet, as a society, it's our desire to see more people taking exercise, to be out enjoying outdoor recreation more often, because we just know the benefits that comes to health, as well as in some places, economic benefits for those rural communities as well. So there are. It's a national government priority to have more people getting into the countryside as well. It's one of the national indicators in the Scottish Performance Framework. So this is a national priority. Therefore, we continue to make the case as in our organisation for more national funding to be spent on access staff within local authorities and so forth. So in terms of, as Anne has mentioned, if you have a Pentland Hills Regional Park, you then have ranger services who are able to give that level. And certainly in some of the documents for this committee meeting, it was mentioning that some of the benefits that landowners get is that they do have a slightly better, a higher level of service from the local authorities because of the Pentland Hills Regional Park management team there. So, yes, it's an ongoing problem. It's about educating the wider society, but at the same time, we don't want to stop people from coming out into the countryside, and it has to be recognised as a national priority and therefore funded. So.
Okay, and just finally, my final question, Convener, if you don't mind, I just wondered, Mr. Barr, I think, touched on a very interesting point when he said that the nature of the people using the countryside has changed over the years, and I wonder if by management we're kind of almost destroying what it is that attracts people to the countryside. I'm thinking of Wordsworth's poem when he started off, "I wandered lonely as a cloud." And so to what extent are we actually destroying what it is people are actually seeking from the countryside when we attempt to manage this situation?
I think we perhaps get to the heart of the conflict that goes on. People want to recreate in the countryside, and they want recreate.
Right, thank you.
Sorry. Yes.
That last question, now, mate.
And land management goes on in the countryside. Food's produced, timber's produced. All sorts of activity, economic activity, takes place, and the two things don't naturally always sit that well together. They can where recreation is light, that the whole thing can be managed quite well. But I think there is, if you like, the countryside is the factory floor of farmers and foresters and so on. And those coming to recreate in the countryside are an outside pressure coming into that. I guess over the years, the type of recreation that happens has changed. So we didn't, you know, mountain bikes have come about, I think, from probably about the 1980s, late 80s, early 90s onwards. Before that, mountain biking wasn't something that was done in any great numbers. And that places a different type of pressure on the countryside. And I think also urban society has shifted. We've become a more urbanised society, and people have less of a natural connection to the types of things that go on in the countryside. So as Bob said earlier, people perhaps naturally have less of an understanding of the type of land management activity that takes place. So there's a whole range of factors that maybe contribute to why that conflict might be more prevalent now than it appears to have been in the past. And it might just be that more people are getting out into the countryside, and that's no bad thing for health and for lots of different reasons. But it does mean that we have to give some support to those that live and work in the countryside, that gain a living from being in the countryside, and that live in the countryside and want a bit of privacy when they're out there, and that does require management. That requires resources. We need to, whether it's by providing waymarked routes so that people avoid potential areas of conflict, whether it's through education and things like ranger services, whether it's about providing facilities for dog walkers, dog bins, and that sort of thing. It's not impossible to manage those conflicts, but it does require a resource.
Thank you. Would you like to come along?
Yes, please. Yes, please. Just as a follow-up to that, actually. And it really stemmed from my colleague Mike McKenzie's question about how you can better manage the pressures that Mr. Barr was referring to. And in terms of this bill, if you increase the designated area of a regional park, you are creating something of a magnet for people to come and enjoy the facilities within that national park, whatever they may be, not national park, sorry, regional park, whatever they may be. And it is the number of people that increase the pressure that requires the management and the resource to avoid the conflict. Is that roughly the equation?
That's absolutely right.
Yes. Yeah. So the potential danger of increasing the designated area within a regional park without having the resource to manage the pressures, to me, would suggest that you might actually diminish the existing park within which there is a degree of management, if that degree of management isn't replicated in the rest of the park as well. Is that a reasonable concern?
Yes. I mean, you could either spread the resource too thinly. So if the existing resource needs to manage the new resource as well, you could spread the whole thing too thinly. Or you concentrate on the areas of greatest pressure, which are probably the existing park because it's closest to Edinburgh, and you don't therefore provide facilities in the extended area. And assuming that there is an increase in people wanting to use it, which is a reasonable expectation if you do create a new boundary and extend it, I think you do raise public expectation. I think they will expect to go to that area and see waymarked routes and see the other things that you'd see in the other part of the park. So I think if it's not there, you potentially disappoint the people that want to recreate there, and you also don't provide the support that land managers need to make the whole thing work.
Yeah. Okay, I think I'm fine with that. But I don't know if anybody else wants.
Yes, please. Just a couple of points you've raised there, the two of you have. The Rangers Service, I've got to commend them. They do a great job for what they have. But 4 o'clock in the afternoon, the schools get out, the kids all arrive, there's no Rangers there. The Rangers Service stops at 4 o'clock. It's funding restraints, I'm sure. There's now very few Rangers covering the whole of the area. It's a massive area to cover, so they're not always going to be on hand when they're required. The biggest problem I see is the education. We've lost the educational side of the Ranger Service. They used to take school classes round and educating these young people on how to behave in the countryside. That no longer happens. That's not just the Ranger Service, that's all over, that's schools all over Scotland. But what the point I really wanted to make was that I've seen what's happened in our existing regional park, whereby the increase in pressure has spoiled the wildlife and the habitat areas. You know, we have at Benalley, for instance, there's what they called sanctuary wood, where there were a lot of bird watchers went there to watch all the birds. now there are so many cyclists and dog walkers going through it that the rarer birds just aren't there any longer. They've moved. I'm seeing the same in Scottish Water have now opened all the reservoirs to the public because they're not used for drinking anymore. And all the woodland around these reservoirs is exactly the same. Harlaw is just, it's like walking down Princess Street some days. Clubbedeen is exactly the same. And these are my concerns, that the people that used to enjoy the wildlife side of it have had to move further afield to see the rarer aspects of it, to some of the periphery of our regional park and possibly into the area we're speaking about. And, you know, we are soaking up the pressure. And I think something needs to be done about that to keep it where it is. Because if we move it, we're just really pushing the pressures further out.
Okay, does Christine, do you have a question? Could I ask you, both yourself and Colin, and the witnesses now, if we can try and keep everything as concise as possible?
I can see time. Thank you, convener. Can I say to Robert Barr, yes, thank you very much for taking me to your farm. I thought you were trying to cause a by-election by perching me next to a precipice, but I gave you the benefit of the doubt. But I absolutely accept everything you've said about, in particular, of interest to me is the changes over the decades and the changes in the usage and so on. Now, having ranted a wee bit about what this bill's actually about, which we all accept is just a line on the map, it doesn't put any obligations on local authorities or MDLs to do anything in particular, and it wouldn't come into effect for 2 years after Royal Assent. So let's just pop that there, because that's all it does. But tangential to that, because I was well aware of the difficulties with the existing park, can you tell me, since I brought this proposal forward, has this made any change in the focus on the various agencies on the existing park, you know, on funding the issues and the pressures? Has this had any kind of, has it been a bit of an agent provocateur with regard to that?
Yes, I think it has. As Janice has said already, we've had a meeting with the Joint Committee and talking about trusts. More funding that comes in, the better, as far as I'm concerned. But I'd like to see the regional park as it is being a success before we try and expand it. And I think when you talk about your line, Christine, I feel the line is a provocateur for bringing more people in. And if the councils are not there to soak up the pressure, who is? The farmers, the landowners, and the land managers. They're going to have to... People will see that. We have two types of park. We have three types of park. There's Benalley Public Park, Benalley Country Park, and Benalley Regional Park. But you ask any member of the public and they won't know the difference.
Can I just say, Robert, you've made the point for me. I don't think people would realise when they're moving from the current regional park out with it. But there is a difference, as we're aware and we know, in the management of the two parts. Can I ask, therefore, you know, what you're saying is absolutely correct. But do you feel there would have been... I shouldn't really ask a question I don't know the answer to. That's what they tell you in court. But I'm going to ask it anyway. Do you feel that there would have been any movement about the financing and concerns and the highlighting the pressures on the current park the way it has happened had I not brought forward this bill?
Well, there was always going to be restraints put on funding, which always creates discussion about it. But yes, it has acted as a catalyst to get things moving, I think.
I don't know if anybody else wants to respond to that particular line, because... My point I'm making is in making a delay for 2 years, which was very specific, if this were to proceed through the various stages, then to Royal Assent and delaying it for 2 years, is that at the very worst outcome, things would remain just a line on the map, neutral and perhaps shrinking budgets to the what was the former part. But in that 2 years, it would also exercise, it's not the point, but it would exercise that pressure about funding, not just for the existing, for the whole park itself, given that we're looking decades ahead, because nothing has changed in decades so far. So putting it to you like that, would you, you know, I don't know if you would comment on that, if you think it would have the same kind of, this went through, it would therefore focus minds on feasibility studies, whatever you like to do, for that two-year period. But if this doesn't go through, none of that will happen.
I would agree. It certainly has the potential to do that. even if in the basic case of just mapping what's already there in terms of car parks and so forth, and we've heard from the other local authorities that there are already core paths and other routes within that area, which they are already managing, and natural heritage sites as well. So it would be a case of just mapping what's there already at the very least, and seeing perhaps where some improvements could be made, maybe if a car park could be extended or what have you.
I think we need to have we need to be much clearer about a funding model before the bill proceeds, I have to say. I think the danger is that we can't at the minute, from what the local authorities have said, they can't see a particularly viable way forward in terms of a funding model. And if we do 2 years down the line get to the stage of an automatically extended park, which is what the bill proposes, whether the authorities can agree or not, then the danger is that we do raise public expectations, we have a new extended park, and yet those expectations can't be met because we don't have the funding to meet them. And I think, as I said before, you either then people go out and don't get the facilities that they think they will get in a regional park, and they're disappointed, and the landowners and managers don't have the support of the local authorities, of a ranger service, and they get they have to deal with the pressure of those additional people. So I really strongly feel that we have to be much clearer about the funding before this goes forward.
Challenge on expectations.
Ask the other panel members if they want to speak first, and then you can come back in. But we are getting close to the end of the session.
Well, certainly, the consultation and the bill has focused minds, but I think local authority pressures, budget pressures, would have been such that we would have had to have a look at funding mechanisms anyway, and look at how we were going to fund the infrastructure within the park on a longer term basis. So it has focused minds, but it would have happened.
May I return just to, it's just that you say it raises expectations. I've had this thrown at me before, but Mr. Barr, you made the point that people don't know when they're moving out of a regional park and into different kinds of parks. It's just countryside to them. It may be they inform people like Ramblers, but for punters and so on going out with a family a walk, they don't really know. So I don't know whether you disagree with Ms. Gray that she says it raises expectations, because apparently, according to you, it makes no difference at the moment.
That's not quite what I was meaning. What I was meaning was I don't think it makes any difference to the different type of park, but the word park, as soon as you put a line on the map and it says park, they feel they can do what they like in it and use it as a public park, regional park, country park.
Okay, right. Thank you.
Questions?
Yeah, it's just actually, as far as I can see from Robert and Anne, I mean, seem to be making my case for why we need a regional park more than anything else. And the fact, if we carry on the way we're going with the unsustainable model that the present park has at this minute in time, we're going to have a situation where it becomes a free-for-all. And in 4 or 5 years' time, when everything's collapsed, it doesn't matter which part of the hill you're on, the local authority is going to have to go out and do something to help, because there will be stresses as the numbers invariably rise. So given the fact that there's a two-year time period for this, and you talk about expectations rising, all that, given the threat at the end of it where local authority finances might be at that point where the present setup is unsustainable, who knows? Certainly I felt that in my day, that it was very, very difficult to come through. Are we not going to get into a situation, if we don't knock heads together over the next couple of years, and actually force local authorities to talk to each other, facilitate the information, and to find the model? Don't we think we're going to end up in this position where there will be almost extreme measures have to be taken at that time to stop people using the land in whichever way they want?
I think there's nothing to stop people spilling out into the whole of the Pentland range at the moment if they want to. The access rights give them that ability, so there's nothing to stop them using the whole of the range for recreational purposes. If the demand's there, local authorities may well have to look at how that's facilitated, whether they do provide an extended range of service, whether they do look at upgrading and improving paths, whether they do put in signage and all the other things that, that might come with that. We don't need an extended boundary line to make that happen. That should be driven by demand. But I kind of suspect, actually, that people, that the demand is at the top end of the Pentland Hills Regional Park because it's so accessible from Edinburgh, from the bypass, and from other surrounding places. We would have to do something to really encourage people to use the southern end if we wanted to spread that demand out, and that requires resources. It doesn't require a line on a map to change. It requires us to identify that we'd like to push people down there and spread the load and find the funding to do that. I don't know whether people are willing to move that far, whether they want to focus on the existing regional park for their recreation or not. I think the trouble for me with the bill is that it does raise all these questions, and that's a completely legitimate discussion to have. But let's have the demand figures, the feasibility, the funding first before we go as far as just putting an arbitrary line on a map.
Can I get a couple of, because I think there's some issues here that are quite fundamental, and it's a case of our communities in the borders or anywhere else for that matter around not expanding their communities over the next few years?
They probably are, but we, you know, from what we've heard from the local authorities, they don't necessarily see the demand for recreation in those areas, in the borders, in South Lanarkshire, coming to that southern end of the park. I think
I don't necessarily accept that as a premise, I have to say. I would really just like to say that the and I hope there is some agreement, because I know Robert from my days in working in the Pentlands, but I do think that there is an element at this moment in time, from what I've heard, saying there is a need for management. The stuff that has been done in the old park has been really good, it's been heard, but we just don't want it in our patch down here.
I don't think that's true at all. There's nobody here is saying that access shouldn't occur in the southern end of the Pentlands, or that people don't want others to, you know, landowners and others living there don't want people to enjoy that countryside. But I think, one, it doesn't necessarily need the boundary line to change for that to happen. But what it does need is resources and financing if we're going to make that happen, because there is potential for clash, and we need to minimise that and make it work.
Aspect.
But I don't know if 2 years is long enough.
Excuse me, can we just bring this to a close, please? I've got one question I'd like to ask the panel, and we are getting to the end of the session. So thanks very much, Colin. Could I ask, this is basically for you, Ms. Winning, could you give me an idea of the additional responsibilities of this extended area if it is designated as part of the regional park?
Sorry, the additional responsibilities on...
That would be required if that extended area became part of the regional park. On local authorities and yourselves and whoever.
Responsibilities, I think there would be additional requirements for visitor management. At what scale would depend on the level of demand. In order to reduce, one of the solutions for conflict resolution is to ensure that we have the correct infrastructure there so that we can manage people who want to go fast on their mountain bikes and separate them from those people who want to take quiet enjoyment of the countryside. And so there will be resources required to create that infrastructure to prevent conflict. And
does anybody else have any views on that?
Just endorse what Janice has said.
Okay, right. Thank you very much. Well, in that case then, we'll just draw this session to a close. I want to thank the panel for their time and their evidence, and that is the meeting officially closed. Thank you.